God. That's his role. It's one of his roles. He's the active member of the Godhead. And so we have to learn to listen to him as leaders. We have to learn to listen to him as people. We have to learn to listen to him as musicians. We have to learn to listen to him as Sunday school teachers. We have to learn to listen to him. We have to learn to listen to him. And you see, there's been a switch. Don't stop playing. There's been a switch in the atmosphere. You see, there was the army was marching before. And I'm thinking, I mean, I've been here before. And I'm going, is it this time, Lord? And then as our brother came and prophesied some of that stuff, I could feel a change coming.
Yes.
See, you just picked it up. You feel it. It's like a wave. It's like a wave. Ruth Heflin, I don't know if you know her, she's got some books out on the glory, but she would say that you praise and you praise and you praise and you praise, and then you come to the place of worship and you worship and you worship until you see his face. You see, you cannot make anything happen. That's what I love about the Holy Ghost, you know. We just have to do what he's telling us to do. We don't have to strive in what we're doing. You know, if we want to know more, we don't have to strive in our prayer. And yet there is a time. See, it's like an oxymoron. There is a time when there's a roar, but there's a time when there's just resting in the shadow of the Almighty. And you've got to know which one it is. And you're on a learning curve, because I'm on a learning curve, so you must be on a learning curve, eh? Wow. And it's okay to make mistakes. Okay, you've got to give your leaders grace to make mistakes. You've got to give your musicians grace to not get it right all the time. What's important is that you move, you get out of the boat. You get out of the boat. And you move like the sea, like the waves rolling in and rolling out. You know, when you read your word, don't strive and wrestle to understand things intellectually, because it'll just mess you up and you'll annoy everybody else, because all you want to do is explain the scriptures, and 9 times out of 10 you got it wrong, because you're seeing it from an earthly perspective. See, you can't earn your salvation. You cannot earn your salvation. You cannot earn favor from God. You already have it, because it's a gift. It's a gift. It says by grace you are saved. In Ephesians 1 and 2 it talks about it. And it's a free gift. And tonight the Holy Spirit wants you to accept the free gift. I'm not talking about just salvation. I'm talking about the gift that Jesus gave you when he was on the cross. It wasn't just about salvation. It didn't stop at the cross. He rose again. He rose again. And what you experience now is nothing to what you can experience, but you cannot earn it. And if you try to strive for it, it won't come the same way, because then it becomes works. And then if you don't get it right, then you feel unworthy and unacceptable to God. It comes in here. It comes in through the soul. And you've got to learn to walk by the Spirit, not by your head, not by your soul, not by your emotions, because it's a walk of faith. And you have to walk by the Spirit. You have to walk by the Spirit. Faith is a realm of the Spirit. There's two types of knowledge in this world. Sense knowledge. That's the stuff that we need to live in this world. You know, we're taught as a baby, don't put your hand on the hot plate. That's sense knowledge. You know, if I walk out in front of a car and he's coming around the corner, he's not going to stop. I'm going to die, probably. That's sense knowledge. So I wait until I can cross the road safely. That's sense knowledge. But I want to tell you about another knowledge. Knowledge. It's revelation knowledge. You see, understanding of the scriptures doesn't come from your intellect to your heart. It comes as you seek His face. Not trying to read 10 chapters of the Bible every day so you can read the Bible through a year. It's actually 5 chapters every day. You know, if that's what you're doing, that's great. I'm not knocking that, but don't do it out of works. Don't do it out of soul. Just relax, and some mornings you might not get your 5 chapters done because your daddy just wants you to enjoy the sunrise. And sitting in your chair and chewing the fat with him. Come on. Come on. It's relationship. It's relationship. Of course we got to get the word in us. But don't go religious on me, okay? Oh, I know there's no one like that here. But don't you get religious on me. You got to read your word. You know, sometimes I get up in the morning, I don't have quiet times anymore. I have relational connection. And sometimes I don't even open the Bible because I'm just sitting with my daddy enjoying the view over the harbour. And I go to work in my office and he starts laying a scripture on my heart. And it starts burning and I'm going, oh, I've got to have a look at that scripture. Got to have a look at that scripture. And then he'll remind me. I keep a journal. You know, when you walk by the Spirit, it's real helpful that you keep a journal. You don't have to be like some of the ladies that are very meticulous and write pages and pages and pages and pages. You know, you can do a man's version, eh? You can do a redneck's version, okay? And you need to learn to write down, have a book. Because I'm going to give you some keys to help you to walk by the Spirit closer to God. Okay, it's got nothing to do with what I was going to share tonight, but that's beside the point. He drops me in it all the time, you know. Here's some things. Get yourself a notebook. Number one. Stop trying to please God and earn His love and affection. You always have. You have it. You have it. You can't do anything to get it anymore. And when you're walking in the bush or driving your car or out in the garden or sitting in a quiet space, stop. Throw your shopping list away. Okay. Shopping list? What are you talking about? Well, I'll tell you what I'm talking about. This is how my quiet. Oh, sorry. Devotional time would go. I'd get in there and I'd have an hour and I'd read my 5 scriptures. And then I'd try and pray for an hour. When it started, it was 5 minutes, and I got bored as a young Christian, you know, because I couldn't figure out how to pray any longer in English for 5 or 10 minutes because I wasn't baptized in the Holy Ghost then. Then I baptized in the Holy Ghost and things changed. They got that Baptist out of me, brother. So, I shouldn't say things like that, should I? I'm not knocking the Baptists. You know, they're good people, okay? But I was a Baptist, you see. And then I got baptized in the Holy Ghost and I became a Penti Baptist. You can be a Pentecostal and be a Baptist too, you know. And anyway, I would go into the prayer closet and I'd have this list of what I needed to pray about. That's the shopping list. Oh God, my car's broken down. Give me a Mercedes-Benz, will you? Oh God, you just have to send some people around today because I'm feeling sad. Oh God, I'm broke and I can't pay the power bill. I need some money. And I'd go through my shopping list and I would cry out to God and He wouldn't get a word in edgeways. Right now, one or two of you are squirming. I'm not knocking, asking my daddy. But you see, we get so religious about how we go about things that we forget that it's a relationship. And we forget how to relate. Okay? This is how you relate. Come here, Lung. I've been born again. And let's pretend she's Jesus. You reckon you can do this? And so I'm now living my life with Jesus. You keep your distance, but keep following me around. And so I'm busy in life, and I'm going around and I'm doing my stuff, and you know, and I'll get busy over here, and I might get further away, and but he's still there, you know. And then I think, oh, I've got a catastrophe. Jesus, can you do that? And then I drift off again. It's not fellowship. This is fellowship. Okay? This is fellowship. And sometimes when I'm walking close with my daddy, I've got nothing to say. Even though I'm broke, even though I might need healing, I just enjoy this company. It's relationship, see? Wow. It's relationship. I don't want what he can give me. I want this. And of course, you know, I'm going to pray for anybody that needs healing. You know, just, I'll pray for a chair if I thought I'd get a miracle.
I got to go.
Anything that moves. You see, God's not far away. He wants to come close. And for some of you, this might be my last night when I say this, but some of you almost need to throw your Bible into the bookshelf for a while, because you've become so religious in your Bible reading that you're not hearing the relationship side of it. You're going after it for the wrong motivation. I got so bored with my devotional life, and I'm sure my daddy was bored with it too. I learned at one stage 1,500 scriptures, and I could quote them off by heart. And that's not a lot compared to some of the navigators I knew. There's one guy who memorized 3,500, and he had a revision process every day of 300 or 400 scriptures, and he was learning more. And so he'd review his 300 or 400 whatever scriptures a day, and then he'd be learning this new one that might take a week or two before he had it off pat. There were patterns in it. But I'm telling you, I knew the scripture, but I didn't know Jesus. You can read the scripture and not know him. I'm not saying you shouldn't read, because you should. But you know who the word is? It's Christ too. It's in him. He's in the word. So that, you know, I'm not saying throw your Bibles away. I'm just saying that if your devotional time is just going through the motions, and there's not a lot of the breath of God in it, maybe you need to put the Bible on the table for a while and just hang with him, with your daddy. Just hang with the Holy Spirit. And just say nothing and read nothing until he speaks to you. When's the last time he spoke? See, you can't, you know, there's a time for war. You know the greatest form of worship? I'm talking about worship, not warfare, not praise. It's silence. When you know that there's nothing more to say because he's here. And you can't talk. Like John, when he saw the angel, all he did was fell on the ground and worship God. I've been in church at 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning, and I didn't want to go home because he was there. I sit in my chair sometimes, and you know, I'm really into leadership stuff, and you know that God speaks through more than just the Bible, through more than just prayer. So the fact that you might read 30 chapters a day, they don't give you no brownie points, man. Good on you for doing it. But if you don't know him, what's the point? And I'd rather feel my daddy's breath on me. I love the scriptures. I love studying the scriptures. But you see, I got so dry, do you have Weet-Bix in this country? No, you don't have Weet-Bix. You don't know what you're missing. But I got so dry. You know, You know when a piece of paper gets all dried up and you pick it up and you screw it up and it all crumbles and drops down? You know, it's lost, you can't open the paper. You know, an old paper, and it's all cracked and crumbly, and you damage it, and it just, that's how dry I got. And I love God. It took him a while to get my attention, but now I've learned to flow in the rhythms of his grace. I learned that prayer was more than on my knees and on my face. I still get on my knees and on my face, but prayer's just conversation. I talk to him all day. You might not hear the vocal cords vibrating, but in my mind, I'm listening. I'm talking to my daddy. And I'm relating to him. And you know, when you begin to hear his voice, you don't have to try and discipline yourself to be good. Because what happens is that his heart and his love melts your heart. And then you find that you don't want to do anything to break that relationship. And so the reading of the word becomes different. Your prayer life becomes different. Fellowshipping, it becomes different. And I can just rest and will enjoy God. And so there's a time for everything. There's a time for everything. And the Holy Spirit is the one that we walk with. Jesus is, isn't it crazy? We walk with three people. I wonder if he's, no, I shouldn't say things like that. I was going to say, I sometimes wonder if he's schizophrenic, but he's not. I can talk like that. Do you know why? Because I know my dad. He's not upset about that. Do you know that your Heavenly Father is very mischievous? Do you know that Jesus also is very, very mischievous? And the Holy Spirit, well, I don't know what to say about him. He's just real mischievous on steroids. You see the atmosphere's changed? And now the rain is starting to fall. Or I don't know what language to put on it, but you see there's an anointing in that plane right now. I don't know what he's doing, but he's doing something. You don't have to know all the time. And so this doesn't just happen in church. This happens in everyday life. Everyday life. And if you're quiet enough and shut your trap long enough, instead of tell him what you need, because he was already aware of your needs, he'll guide you in a way which you long for intimacy. You know, he doesn't stand around with a baseball bat waiting to whack you around the ears because you've done something wrong. You know, some people have a concept of God that way. But he's my dad. You know, and you know that I'm not perfect, and I know that you're not perfect, but he doesn't care. He just loves on us. His love melts my heart. His love melts your heart. And sometimes we got to go to the quiet place. And sometimes he just wants to take a walk in the garden that you love and share it with you. He doesn't just want to walk behind you like Lynn was walking behind me. He doesn't want to do that. He wants to be right here, admiring the flowers if you are gardeners, admiring the rifle if you're a hunter. He's got so many faces and so many facets. So many faces and so many facets. You will never find them all. You will spend the rest of your life until he returns discovering new faces of God. You'll find new faces. And he loves to just give you surprises. You see, I'm talking about relationship. You know, to just sit at his feet and not have to do anything. And sometimes he gives you assignments and you do something. So this book thing that I talked about, learn. If you think God's speaking to you, write it down. You know, you don't have to be. I'm not a good writer, but I've got a diary. I mean, the woman wouldn't call it a diary, you know, because sometimes it might be 4 days before I start something in it, you know. And I can look back over my diary, and I can, because I write down, and I'll go, oh, I feel God saying this. And you know, this happened today. It might be only a one-liner for me. For me, I'm bottom line. I don't want to hear all the flowery stuff, you know. And I have to learn patience sometimes. Just give it to me, you know, what's the bottom line? Because I'm a busy man. But, you know, you can do it however God leads you to do it. And then as you walk the journey, you begin to learn, how do I say it? You begin to learn intimacy in a way which you've longed for that have. See, we all long for more intimacy, don't we? I do. I want to know my Jesus. You know, Paul said, I would give everything away, his experience prior to him being released as an apostle after the Damascus experience. You know, he saw miracles. He saw God deliver him out of prison. He got beaten up. He got left for dead several times. You just go on and on and on and on and on. And he talks about it in the epistles that I just give it all up just to know him. All that I've experienced now, all the great things, you know, I mean, being left for dead, I wouldn't call that great. All right? But he didn't mind suffering for Jesus. But the incredible things that he saw. Can you imagine? I'd love to see half of what he saw. I don't want the other stuff, you know, the beatings and stuff. I don't really want that. But he'd give it all away just for intimacy. That's how I read that scripture. And I'd give it all away just to feel the breath of my daddy. If he said, well, you know, you can see me like Moses did, but you'll have to give up traveling and ministering. I'd do it. I'd do it just like that. Because that'd be worth giving up for. Jesus. So as you do that, do you know what? You need to learn to laugh at yourselves too. That's something, and you're pretty, well, this guy's pretty good at it. And some of you guys at breakfast this morning, I was just shocked and shell-shocked at your sense of humor. I didn't know what to, no, I'm just joking. We had a good time. You see, and here's the thing about relating with Jesus, okay? It is not just him and me, vertical. But there's God that lives inside of this man. There's God that lives inside of this lady. And this one. There's God that lives inside of each and every one of you. And you see, when we get together and we have fellowship, God does this. God to God, if I can say it that way. Because the Holy Spirit in him will speak to me at times. And so that's why fellowship is important. You know, I don't come to church because I should come to church and then I'll be a good Christian. Sometimes when I'm coming to church, I think I've got better things to do, especially when I drive down the hill and I see the harbor calm like glass. I reckon it'd be better to go fishing. No, I'm just joking. But I do think about it. I think, God, it's Sunday morning. I'm not preaching. Can I go fishing? I don't hear nothing. Now, I love church, but I'm just being honest with you. It crosses my mind. But you see, I make a choice, and I'm never disappointed. Some of our leadership meetings, I choose to make a choice, and I'm never disappointed. Because on Saturday mornings, it's my day off. I don't get many. And I think, oh, I don't really want to get up. I want to sleep, and I haven't slept in for about 3 or 4 months. You know, give me a break, Jesus. And it's a real... I have to make a choice to go to that meeting. And every single time I go, I am glad I went. You see? And so it's some of those things. Walking by the Spirit. You know? Keep a journal. Go to the pictures with Jesus. Go hunting with Jesus. Whatever you do. Go golfing with Jesus. Golf. Jesus and I go golfing every Monday. He's a better golfer than me too. And I, you know, I'm being serious. I am not being a fruit loop, okay? This is relationship. And I hear him sometimes when I think I've done a good shot, and I'm going, it's not that good, Graham. Because he's my dad. He loves to have fun with his kids. And you see, when Jesus ascended into heaven and he left the Holy Spirit, that means that he can be on the golf course with me, and he can be in your favorite shop for women shopping away, and he's with you. How does that work? Because he's the Holy Ghost. You see, it's all about relationship. It's all about relationship. Wow. Jesus. You know, sometimes I just have to wait because I don't know what's happening next. Do you get that? Can you feel the atmosphere right now? It's like the wave at the beach just washing over you. And it's the Holy Spirit that's... And sometimes you just got to make room for him to do whatever he wants to do. Come on. Yeah. Sharamarande. Holy. Come on. Jesus. Woo. Sharamarande. Can I ask you to do something for me if you can? I want you to just get up out of your seats and come out the front. Because there's a sound that's starting to rise. No, don't do it for me. You're going to have some God encounters. No, I'm not going to pray for you. You're going to have some God encounters. You don't need me. We just need to come and soak in the river. We need to come and soak in the river. Linda, can you chuck me my bottle of water? It's okay. And if you want to sit down, come and sit on the front seats. It's okay. You don't have to stand. But come on up close, because there's a river starting to flow. Yeah. Now, I want to ask you some questions, okay? So don't stop playing on me, but just keep it down a little bit for a minute. Come on, God. I have this $10 note. I'll put it up there for a minute. And I want to do a little demonstration. I'm going to take a drink of water. Who knows that water is symbolic of the Holy Ghost? So is oil and fire too. Okay? You with me? I'm not teaching heresy. Watch this. I took a drink. Now I defy you to take a drink and pray at the same time. I'll give you the $10 note if you can do that and not spill any water on the floor. Any takers? Start to pray. It's got to be Sharabaka Sharabada. I'm not going to pull that water on me now. Oh, that's not very Christian. And that won't please God. Well, let me tell you something. Jesus said this. He said that I have water that you do not know of. And if you learn to drink of me, streams of living water will begin to flow in your life, and you won't need this stuff. You will, but he was talking about something. And he said, from out of your bellies will flow rivers of living water. And when the, remember the flood? Noah, he built a boat. He built an ark. And when the water started to pour out, it says that the rains came from outside. It came down from the heavens and it came up out of the deep at the same time. And it flooded the earth. It just wasn't raining this way. It was raining this way. And to me that's symbolic. You, the Bible says that you have river inside of you, and out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. That's what the Bible says. God wants to fill you up to overflowing. So is there any takers, or I can put that back in my pocket? Going, going, gone. Because I know you can't do it, and you know. This is the point that I'm trying to make. There are times when you just need to learn to receive from God. And you know, and I know, that when we pray in tongues, it's the Spirit of God in us rising up and interceding. And it's a good thing to do, because he's never had a prayer go unanswered. And he's never prayed out of the will of God. And when I But if I'm doing that and God's wanting to give you something, there's water coming out of here, and he's trying to get water in here, and you just need to relax and open up and receive. I'm not being legalistic about this. I'm giving you a key that will radically change your life. Come on, let's worship. And let's just soak. It's good to soak in the river. When you've got a dirty stain on a t-shirt, what do you do with it, ladies? The stain in the t-shirt begins to loosen before you put it in the wash, eh? And you put it in the washing machine and it comes off, doesn't it? You can never soak enough in the river of God. And I've seen people change. Sometimes they don't have anything happen to them. You might not feel anything tonight, but that doesn't mean to say that God isn't touching your life, because he is.